It's not that pseudoscience and superstition and new age so-called beliefs and fundamentalist zealotry are something new. They've been with us for as long as we've been human. But we live in an age based on science and technology with formidable technological powers.
Science and technology are propelling us forward at accelerating rates.
That's right. And if we don't understand it, by we, I mean the general public, if it's something that, oh, I'm not good at that, I don't know anything about it, then who is making all the decisions about science and technology that are going to determine what kind of future our children live in?
What's the danger of all this? I mean, you know, this is not the thing that...
There's two kinds of dangers. One is what I just talked about, that we've arranged a society based on science and technology in which nobody understands anything about science and technology. And this combustible mixture of ignorance and power, sooner or later, is going to blow up in our faces. And the second reason that I'm worried about this is that science is more than a body of knowledge. It's a way of thinking, a way of skeptically interrogating the universe with a fine understanding of human fallibility. If we are not able to ask skeptical questions, to interrogate those who tell us that something is true, to be skeptical of those in authority, then we're up for grabs for the next charlatan, political or religious, who comes ambling along. It's a thing that Jefferson laid great stress on. It wasn't enough, he said, to enshrine some rights in a constitution or a bill of rights. The people had to be educated and they had to practice their skepticism and their education. Otherwise, we don't run the government. The government runs us. You see, people read the stock market quotations and financial pages. Look how complex that is. People are able to look at sports statistics. Look how many people can do that. Understanding science is not more difficult than that. It doesn't involve greater intellectual activities. But the thing about science is, first of all, it's after the way the universe really is and not what makes us feel good. And a lot of the competing doctrines are after what feels good and not what's true.
There are millions of people who understand science does not prove religion, but because religion is faith-based.
Let's look a little more deeply into that. What is faith? It is belief in the absence of evidence. Now, I don't propose to tell anybody what to believe, but for me, believing when there's no compelling evidence is a mistake. The idea is to withhold belief until there is compelling evidence. And if the universe does not comply with our predispositions, okay, then we have the wrenching obligation to accommodate to the way the universe really is. So who is more humble? The scientist who looks at the universe with an open mind and accepts whatever the universe has to teach us, or somebody who says everything in this book must be considered the literal truth, and never mind the fallibility of all the human beings involved in the writing of this book? I lost both my parents about 12 or 15 years ago, and I had a great relationship with them. I really miss them. I would love to believe that their spirits were around somewhere, and I'd give almost anything to spend 5 minutes a year with them.
Do you hear their voices ever?
Sometimes. About 6 or 8 times since their death, I've heard it. Carl, just in the voice of my father or my mother. Now, I don't think that means that they're in the next room. I think it means that
they're in your head.
I've had an auditory hallucination. I was with them so long, I heard their voices so often. Why shouldn't I be able to make a vivid recollection?
Here's what's interesting about this for me. You convinced me a long time ago that it was arrogant for me or for anyone else to believe that there wasn't some life outside of our
To exclude the possibility.
To exclude the possibility was an arrogance of intellect that we should not assume. You couldn't prove it, you didn't know it was there, but the arrogance for you.
Right, we don't know if it's there, we don't know if it's not there. Let's look.
And if you take that, mm-hmm. why can't you say, there's a lot we don't know?
There's a lot of power there that we don't know.
You know?
It's what I believe.
About.
But that doesn't mean that every fraudulent claim has to be accepted. We demand the most rigorous standards of evidence, especially on what's important to us. So if some guy comes up to me in a channeler or a medium and says, I can put you in touch with your parents. Well, because I want so terribly to believe that,
yeah.
I know I have to reach in for added reserves of skepticism because I'm likely to be fooled and much more minor to have my money taken.
You are living with myelodysplasia.
Or I have been.
You have been. And just share with us, because of your sense of language and your sense of understanding and being reflective and introspective, what do you think about and what does it do for you to
I didn't have any near-death experiences. I didn't have a religious conversion. But you
thought about what it would be like to die.
Certainly, and what it would be like for my family. Right. And I didn't much think about what it would be like for me, because I don't think it's likely there's anything that you think about after you're dead.
That's it.
Yeah, long dreamless sleep. I'd love to believe the opposite, but I don't know of any evidence. But one thing that it has done is to enhance my sense of appreciation for the beauty of life and of the universe and the sheer joy of being alive.
You had a healthy portion of that before this, but even you, it happens to.
Oh, there's no question.
Appreciation.
No question. Every moment, every inanimate object, to say nothing of the exquisite complexity of living beings. You imagine missing it all, and suddenly it's so much more precious.